Father sets before us life and death. He sets before us blessings and curses. He sets before us the privilege to step over into all the abundance of His life and of His glory. Or we can choose to live our own life. But having an encounter with Jesus Christ and having an encounter with the majesty of His presence and of His person should result in the decision having been made. One, it should say the right attitude and the right response should be, "Oh God, You're giving all of this to me. I can have all of this. This is for me." And then it becomes so apparent to us the full scale of what it is, the majesty and the grandeur of what it is, that we sell everything that we have, forsake everything that we have to lay hold on what He's given. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Or we choose to just live our own life, but it shouldn't be a mixture. We shouldn't be double-minded, be halting between two opinions. You could be seated. I'm going to spend a little time with you here in the Word. Thank you, everybody. It's just probably so blessed. Listen, Joshua, you could just stay there. Just stay there. John, just stay there. Just some of you, just stay there. Maybe. Hallelujah. I don't know what I'm going to do next. Hallelujah. Prasuritifikinama. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We just want to be used by God to cause you to step over into the realms of the Holy Ghost, find out how wonderful it is, and so that you would live there for the rest of your life. And if you live there, there are going to be a growth and a maturity of His divine expressions in your life, the signs and the wonders, the miracle, the display of His power and of His glory that He purposed, that which Joel prophesied when he said He had poured out His Spirit upon all flesh, not just some flesh, all flesh. And once again, it's just not some kind of little, you know, event. It is the greatest display of the power of God that has ever come to men. And so tonight, I pray that if things somehow were scaled back for you to where that you didn't really fully realize all that God has done for you, you begin to have a look at Jesus Christ tonight and recognize, wait a minute, Father has not in any way purposed that any of us live as some kind of common, ordinary citizens below the measure of His only begotten Son, for He's purposed that we find this our life in Him tonight. And that we pray that you'll understand that any area that you don't find your life in Him tonight, God has made a provision so that you can find your life in Him tonight. And God's calling all men everywhere to repent. He's calling you to repent. God is calling men to repent and be converted, to change and become that which He has purposed us to be conformed no longer to the world. There's too many people that are willing to look like the world, accommodate the world, act like the world, want to participate with the world, want to be acceptable by the world, think that they've got to look, smell, and act like the world in order for the world to listen to them. That's not what Jesus did. I'm telling you, He had a powerful impact, and He was all about heaven. There was no conforming to the world in Him. He was completely surrendered over to the will of God and was revealing the Father, who is holy, 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 who is absolutely other and opposite of everything that is in the world, and He had a major impact. And I'm telling you now, God's calling us people now in this place to be conformed to the image of Christ, to get real with Him, to let God the Holy Ghost shine the floodlight of heaven upon your soul, to sort things out where you find yourself coming up short of that which the Word of God describes. You will not accommodate it. As long as you will accommodate it, you will never be broken before Him. As long as you accommodate it, your will never be bent to His will. As long as you accommodate it, you'll be self-justified, and you'll never step over into that justification, that which is by faith, that one that He gave to us when He gave to us His own life and gave to us a glorious realm of the baptism of all that He Himself possesses. The baptism of the Holy Ghost and fire that Joel talked about, that He said He would pour out His Spirit upon all flesh, is the greatest display of the power of God that humanity has ever been able to encounter. And we made it something far less. We made it some little charismatic expression. We made it something less than what it is. And people. God's looking for some people who will set his heart, and he's looking for any people anywhere, and he's given you and I an opportunity here in this place to set our heart on the glorious treasures, the riches of his blessing, the riches of his presence. Hallelujah, the riches of his life, the riches of his ways, all that he himself possesses. He's looking for a people who will walk around in the, and share the inheritance and be a partner in the covenant. Hallelujah. And the reality of it is when you look at all that God has provided for us, surely there's no question about it. It goes way beyond any human realm and anything that a human person, any human being can attain to, but God made you a new creation and gave you the power of the Holy Ghost to be able to do these things. But it's a life by the Spirit. It's a life of supernatural power. It is a life that you live by the Holy Ghost. No, you cannot live it by your own life and spirit. You live it by the power of the Holy Ghost that's been made available to you. And that's why we're called to live out and depend upon and walk in the Holy Spirit. And then understand that there's a rule, the rules of it, the rules of it, the divine power that has been given to us, that has made us partakers of the divine nature, where the glory and the person of Jesus Christ can be revealed in our life, because we clean escape the corruption that is in the world through lust, causes us to have a disposition that, oh, I'm adding to my faith purity. I'm giving myself today to purity. I'm walking in purity. I'm walking in holiness, Holy Ghost. I love purity. I love holiness. And I thank you that you're teaching me to walk in this display of your glorious overcoming power that has overcome the world. Yes, that makes that right there changes the dynamics of your decision making of the things that you're going to do and things that you're going to allow in your life. When you begin to give yourself to just brotherly kindness, for example, and divine love that is in that list, I'm telling you, there's never a opportunity for you to speak foul or bad or against anyone or have a bad attitude even against anyone. Because the compassions of the Lord Jesus Christ begins to move you, and when the compassions of Jesus Christ are willing to move you, or begins to move you, you go be crucified for them. You go lay down your life for them. Hallelujah. The love of God will begin to be displayed in your life that you would withhold nothing. And when that's the disposition of your heart, you're surely not going to have a bad attitude towards anyone. Oh, the display of his life and of his goodness. But see, what happens is we'll sit around and we'll listen to this wonderful realm of life that God has called us into, that we will look at it like as some kind of distant hope that we can't obtain to. And, you know, hope deferred makes your heart sick and you look sick. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus, I command that to change tonight. You don't look sick anymore. Praise God. But what happens is you begin to desire these things more than anything else. It's your treasure. Hallelujah. It's something that is so valuable to you and so important to you that you're willing to sell everything that you have. You're willing to let God examine you. You're willing to let God sort you out. You're willing to let God show you what's standing in the way. And as soon as you see it, you abhor it instead of trying to defend its right to be in your life. It's not a time when you see that, after such a long time as this or short time as this, whatever the case may be with you, that the demonstration of the Holy Ghost and the power of the life of Jesus Christ is to be being manifested as it should. It should result in a brokenness instead of a self-accommodation. I am distraught over people who sit around seemingly so happy and contented with their state of powerlessness in Jesus. I'm overwhelmed so many times. I look at people that are just so content and so happy and so joyful about the lack of the demonstration of the life and power of Jesus in their life. Well, that shows that there's something wrong with your heart, and God wants to sort that out for you tonight so that you begin to hunger and thirst after righteousness and God can fill you. You begin to seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things begin to be added unto you. There's nobody who seeks God that doesn't find him. I'm telling you right now, he's giving you opportunity to where everything that comes out of your mouth, you hear it and answer it. And Father has the right to try you. Once again, I've got to emphasize this because these things are very precious to him and very sacred to him. And if you don't want them more than anything else, if you don't want them so much that it brings you to a brokenness that you don't have them, then you can't. You will violate the sacredness of it if it was placed in your life. I've watched too many people step into just an outpouring of God and display of the Spirit of the Lord in their life, immediately fall away into sin, you know, because they weren't willing to be established in the things of the Spirit, and then go ahead and keep falling away deeper and deeper and deeper until now they're gone. Father wants to get things right in your spirit. He wants to get things right in your word. In your heart, and he does that through his word. Hallelujah. Christ Jesus, in his written word, as he describes to us how we're supposed to live and behave ourselves. And the places that you're not willing to do the word of God. Somebody said, well, I just don't have the gifting of prayer. That's nonsense. Everybody that's born of God has the gifting of prayer, because the Holy Spirit has come on the inside of you. Someone said, oh, patience is just not my gifting. That is nonsense. Patience is a fruit that you've been born of God. It has nothing to do with the gifting. Hello. People come along and say, well, I'm not that spiritual. You better get spiritual. Somebody says, oh, well, I'm just not very spiritual, and act like that's some kind of badge of honor in the kingdom of God. That now they're supposed to be an icon of what you're supposed to follow. They're supposed to be something, you know, valuable and cool in the spirit. No, you need to get right with God, because he told you you're supposed to be desiring and coveting the spiritual. Come on, people. I'm tired. I hope you get sick and tired of accommodating a bunch of religious false witness of Jesus. Starting with yourself. You're willing to walk around with less than compassionate and less than kind and considerate people around you. You're willing to walk around less than the demonstration of the power of the Holy Ghost in your life, a description of what it means to be raised up together with Jesus and seated with him in the heavenly realm. Hallelujah. If you'll lay hold on God, I'm going to tell you right now, everything that belongs to him, all that he's described in his word, those things will be witnessed in our life. He's purposed for it to be that way. I just want to read a couple of verses of scripture to you. And I want to start off with this. And just look with me real quickly in Luke chapter 5 and verse 17. You know, I really have no intention on keeping you long tonight. I don't know how long the Holy Spirit is going to keep you in the place. Hallelujah. I didn't have any intention on keeping people very long this morning. Had no idea it was 2:30 in the afternoon when we finally left. But I tell you right now, I like those times where, you know, the only people that are left are the people that were interested in the altar time. Hallelujah. It just starts getting more powerful, and the display of God's glory gets sweeter and more, hallelujah, more glorious. Hallelujah. But I like to just skip everything, go right to that. Hallelujah. But we're going to give everybody an opportunity to be a part of that. Praise the name of Jesus. Oh, take hold right now. Masate. Take hold right now. Take hold right now. People want to go do signs and wonders and miracles and then don't flow and function really in the Holy Ghost until they get there. Forget about it. You'll be one giant flop. You listen to me. If you want to do signs and wonders, go to the nation, do signs and wonders and miracles, my goodness gracious, you better take hold of it now. You better get a hold of something now in your life, because then you're going to be up against something you don't even know anything about. I'm getting ready to go to Cuba. I don't know who's going to go to Cuba with me. I honestly do not know who's going to go to Cuba with me, because I know what it's like to confront a place like Cuba where the powers of darkness have fortified the advancement of the kingdom of God against it. And if you don't have any more anointing than the average Christian, you're just going to be messed up. You're going to be taken out. I already know. I know the drill. I've been there. I've already been there. You have to wait till you get so baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire that the display of the power of God is effective in your life right now, so that you know how to keep the kingdom of God first. Some people can't even make it to the church. Demon spirits keep them from making it to the church. And it's an excuse that they have. Work, play, sick, bed, tired, something else. And if the powers of darkness are able to stand against you on that level, my goodness, you're going to be dead after something like Cuba. You won't even be alive anymore. Honestly. And God in His mercy and His grace just leaves so many people in a place where that they don't move forward because they're not willing to move forward. They don't inherit more of the things of the Spirit because they're not willing to do much with what they've already got. Hallelujah. And it's a good thing to praise God. You know, it's a good thing to praise God over it. That He's not willing, you know, to get you, to allow you to go beyond what you're able. We found this over and again. Don't let people go out in the street and begin to minister to other people who are lost unless they've got a prayer life. Because they're going to be taken out right, left, and center. Because they're going, they're advancing on Satan's territory without the proper armament and equipment. Huh? And they don't have no ability to stand. They're just doing it on their own. Satan will show you, you're no match for him. You start invading his territory, he looks at you and says, I know, I'll make you do what I want. I'll make you down. I'll make you dance to my tune and once, at least once a day. I'm gonna bring up a reprisal against you for coming into my territory. Listen to me. Hallelujah. I'll take Ruth in anywhere. Amen. Hallelujah. Cade? He's with her. Hallelujah. And he's learning that much more, how to take hold of things of the Spirit. Praise God. Hallelujah. I can take my family because they'll just hide away. I'll just say, just do this, and they'll do it. They won't argue with it or smile and act like they agree with it and go say something bad about it later. And not a person in my family would do that. Praise God. Hallelujah. I don't believe that a person in the family of God should do that either. I pray that you won't do that. I pray that you just, because you're interacting with God, you're not interacting with man. Spirit of the Lord's here come to minister to you. Hallelujah. He's come to establish you. How does He establish you? He teaches you line upon line, precept upon precept. He teaches you one verse at a time. He teaches you how to have the right disposition, how to have the right heart. He tells you to be clothed with humility and walk in love, and that will be a protection against everything that comes out against you. He tells you how to keep yourself by His mighty power. He tells you how to find yourself in a place of yieldingness to Him so Satan isn't able to come and overthrow you. He gives you great confidence and authority, saying, I'm on the inside of you, and I'm greater than everyone on the outside of you. Hallelujah. So that, hallelujah. This is the overcoming power. It gives us the faith that conquers the world. Hallelujah. He tells us that we're one with Him. He's in us. We're in Him. Praise God. I'm telling you right now that sometimes I've watched as that somehow puts people in a position like, you know, it's like that. Now they don't have to do anything. It's all finished. And rather than having an opportunity to be empowered by God, to be accepted by God, to go ahead and pursue everything that He has for you. You know, when Jesus said it's finished, He didn't say you're finished. He said salvation that was planned and prophesied since the garden is finished. Huh? He said that which God had purposed and brought to pass so that all men everywhere might be able to repent and be saved and life be changed, it's finished. Amen. That Satan and his power to overthrow men forever is finished. Amen. It's finished. Now He's made a way for you and I to be finished in Him, to be complete in Him, praise God. That's going to be some obedience, amen. That's going to be laying hold on this glorious salvation, not taking for granted that which God has done, not beginning to recognize, wait a minute, He's given us a changed life to live a new life, and we can't allow any other kind of life to exist. Still, many people allow themselves to choose fellowship with demon spirits, to choose the world, to be conformed to the world, to fellowship with the things of this world. Did you know that sexual immorality has been a god that has been worshipped at least since Nimrod? And we have evidence to believe that it was even worshipped before Nimrod. Sexual immorality, worship. There were symbols that were literally worshipped, bowed down to sacrifices, an idol presented as a god. Nothing's changed here, people. You're still bowing to the same angel. You're still bowing to the same angel of darkness. You're still bowing to the same Satan. Listen to me. You're still bowing to the same demon spirits. Man, don't you bow no more to those idols. Don't you bow no more to those demon spirits. It's about time that you be crucified to the world and the world be crucified to you so you can move on with God. It's about time for you to hear God say, I've given you a kingdom. I'm leading you into something that lasts forever. I've given you a place in the holies of holies. You seated together with me in a place that is far above even angels. And that's something that's so wonderful and glorious, and you it's so valuable to you. It's more important than the very life that you now live in the natural. More important to you, the breath that you breathe. It's more important than the food that you eat. Laying hold on eternal life is laying hold on the life of God. Recognizing that you can live out the life of God and understand the characteristic of it and understand the value of it. And understand the expression of it. The Word of God is here to define it for us, and the Holy Ghost is here to breathe upon our lives and make it happen. His wind of the Spirit is here to blow through our lives every day, to fill us and overwhelm us with His glory every day. Father wants to train you how to have the expressions of heaven in your life. That's why He says, build up yourself in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost, keeping yourself in the love of God. There's where God wants to teach you. There's where God wants to instruct you. There's where God wants to develop you. So many people don't have time to be developed by God. They're just too busy with their life in this world. The Lord says you're supposed to hate your life in this world. What happened to that part? Well, that part has got to be addressed before you're ever going to go ahead and move on with your life in God. It's about time somewhere somebody begins to desire those things which Father's made available to us against above all other things. Amen. And here's what I found. I found that when you're no longer willing to have anything less than signs and wonders and miracles in your life, that then all of a sudden you're going to begin to be broken before Him. When you lay hands on the sick and they don't get healed, you get broken before Him. When you begin to cast out a devil and you don't see somebody delivered, you begin to get broken before Him. You don't just write it down as a statistic and just go move on past it like it was not a big deal. You just reckon you have to confront your powerlessness. You have to confront the areas of your life that are not yielded to the Holy Ghost. Huh? Somebody said, well, I just witnessed to everybody. Well, the Mormons witnessed to everybody, too. So what? Somebody said, well, I witnessed to everybody. Well, the Jehovah's Witnesses do, too. So what? When's the last time somebody got saved and planted in the church through all your witnessing? That should come and rebuke you real quickly. Are you listening to me? Father's given us an authority to break off the yoke. Come on, give me a break. God demands fruit. People want to sit back in some repose of something, some little thing they did that barely even qualifies as being the fruit of the Spirit, barely even qualifies as some expression of the power of God in their life. And then what happens, if you'll get right with God and have a right response before God, you'll become broken before Him. You'll be unwilling to allow your life to go on without these things when you know that Father has ordained them and commanded them to be. And suddenly you'll begin to let God search you out. And you'll say, Father, what's wrong with me? Oh, God, change me. Oh, God, help me to understand. Help me to see. Brokenness. Brokenness. Rare characteristic today, expressed in every revival of the past, but now secular humanism. Right now, modernism and postmodernism and secular humanism dominates the minds of God's people, and it's all about you being happy, bless you. And it's all about you being, you know, well taken care of and feeling good about yourself, bless you. And having a lot of self-confidence and self-esteem, bless you. And having a lot of positive thinking and just speaking positive words over yourself and always feeling good about everything you do, bless you. That's secular humanism. That's not the Spirit of God. Hello. I said that's secular humanism, postmodernism. It is not the Word of God. It's not the kingdom of God. It's not the things of the Spirit that produces brokenness and contriteness before the living God. Humility and emptiness so that He can come fill you. Self's got to move out the way so God the Holy Ghost can be expressed. And that's the crisis and it's a crucible. So many people have bought into this. People don't want to be in small churches. They want to go high in big mega churches where there's no accountability, where there's nobody to look into their life and hold them responsible and hold them accountable for the lack of obedience. people, it's time for there to be somebody, somewhere. God's revivals, God's moving, God's outpourings always started in places where people were just desperate for Him. They didn't have anything else to fall back on. If they didn't have God, they didn't have nothing. They wanted to see their lost loved ones come into the kingdom of God. They wanted to see their lost friends come into the kingdom of God. They began to deal with their inability to have any persuasion over the people that were around them about the reality of heaven and the reality of hell. And it drove them to their knees because they began to recognize in the scripture that that authority and that power was made available, and somehow they were absent of it. Somehow they had not stepped into the glory of it, and they begin to seek God. They begin to cry out. They begin to become broken before Him, and His presence begin to stir, and revival begin to form. Somebody said, "We in revival now?" I don't see that. I see a bunch of happy Christians being that much more happy and being that much less effective. Huh? Listen, come on now. Come on, people. There's going to have to be some soul searching, some deep groanings. There's going to have to be something besides play songs. There's going to have to be songs that causes us to be broken and contrite before the living God. There's going to have to be prayers that causes us to be broken. There's going to be reality checks in our life. There's going to be confrontation with the Spirit of the living God. There's going to have to be words of confession in our mouth of where we come back to God and we repent and we say, "Father, forgive me for pursuing my own interests and living my own life." Holy Spirit has some strong inspirations and some strong movings. He will begin to pull your heart with great compassion for the lost around you. And tell you the people that you've been willing to walk by in just a smug attitude and say hello, I'm more concerned about how they feel about you than how they feel about God. Huh? There's so many people, they got more concerned about how people feel about them rather than how they think about them, what they consider them to be, rather than what they think about God and how they consider God to be. Come on, people, let's come on, it's time for the reality of the fruits of the Spirit. God's coming and looking at the tree and He's demanding fruit.
Yes, Lord.
Father wants to fill you with His compassion. He wants to fill you with His love. And out of that, He'll fill you with signs and wonders and miracles too. Yes. Hallelujah. Out of that, He'll fill you with a zeal and a boldness and a confidence to be able to stand up against everything that comes at you. Huh? Nobody had to go through what Paul had to go through. God allowed an angel of darkness to go everywhere with him and persecute him and stir up trouble against him, constantly stand up against him. So Paul called it a thorn in his side. He sought God to take it away from him because he was constantly being harassed by an angel, not a demon, an angel. An angel of darkness. It wasn't a couple of demons, a couple of little lust demons to keep him at bay. It took an angel to stop. It took an angel. God allowed an angel of darkness. He allowed it. God allowed an angel of darkness. That was all that could possibly threaten Paul. Huh? And that didn't slow him down. He said, "My grace is sufficient. I've given you the ability to stand up against that angel, kick him around." Hallelujah. So what? You get in a boat and he stirs up a storm. So what? You go to a town they like you to start off with, the next thing you know, they're stoning you. So what? Huh? People, come on now. We have so much more today, and it seems to be we do far less with it. We have so much more money. We have so much more freedom. See, we live in a time where the church has never known such freedom. Where the church had never, this is Western society because this isn't in Kashmir Valley. This isn't so much even in China. This isn't so much in Nepal. This isn't so much in many other nations that I can name right now, North Korea. We have a society that has been, as it were, almost a partner and at least has accommodated Christianity and the advancement of the gospel in Western society. It is relatively a modern phenomenon. Prior to that, nations and governments were against the preaching of the gospel. And so the people of the kingdom of God were always a persecuted minority and left in a place of affliction and torment and poverty. Read your history book. And it's going to go back to that because we're going to be hated by all nations for His name's sake. And governments are going to be ever increasingly growing opposed gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, and with this window of opportunity, we're going to run and not sit on our blessed assurance, twiddling our thumbs, being all overwhelmed by our own lack and trying to accommodate our self-interest. Huh? I got many things to say right there, but I go to meddling for sure. Sometimes meddling is good. And people just seem don't respond properly to it. If I meddled in your personal affairs and you responded properly to it, then that would be good. But, you know, I'm not going to do it right now. Set up a meeting with me and I'll be happy to give you a list of a rundown of the problems and the issues that's going on in your life. Just come sit in front of me and say, come on, talk to me. You're not going to hurt my feelings. You're not going to cause me to turn away from the faith. I just want the floodlight of heaven. Father, I want you to enumerate the things that have been holding me back. Hallelujah. I haven't had too many people ever come have a meeting, a pastoral meeting, for me to search out their problems and their hindrances. They just want to come try to get me to settle some issue that they want to resolve in their life because they want to feel better about themselves in the situation. Hallelujah. I got one person laughing in the Holy Ghost. Amen, couple now. Praise God. It's true. But I think better things of you. Hallelujah. I think better things of you. Hallelujah. I'm looking at the people who've been crucified together with Christ by a miracle crucifixion. You no longer live. Hallelujah. You rightfully have earned a new name. Hallelujah. That's written down in heaven because you no longer live. So you shouldn't even have the name, the earthly one given you. That's why you got a new name written down in heaven. Hallelujah. Because it's a new life and you live it out and you've got the badge of it. Hallelujah. You've walked away from the riches and the accommodations of men and the provision of your life, of your own life, and the things that you can gain for yourself in this world, and you hate your life in this world because you discovered a life that you can have in the realms of the Spirit. Hallelujah. Amen. You want that life. Yes. There's so much work to do. There's so many people that can be reached. If you'll just get saved, hallelujah, get washed in the blood of the Lamb and filled with the Holy Ghost, God will give you a vision and a plan for San Diego and all the opportunities that you have all around you. Turn me up. Somebody got to hear me. Yeah. Hallelujah. Turn me up. You guys, turn your hearing aid down. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Them hearing aids in the sound booth is just a terrible thing. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Katarama seketayaha. Hallelujah. Ambroshan deli kiparoya. Somebody said, well, aren't you afraid to go into Kashmir? Aren't you concerned about what might happen in Cuba? Aren't you concerned about what may take place over there in Dengadi, Nepal, because of the threatenings that are going on by the fundamental Hindus? No, not at all. I'm already in heaven. Huh? All you can do is kill the body and it'd be raised up later, but I'm in heaven either way. Hallelujah. I'm already in heaven. Hallelujah. 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 Huh, baby? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Huh? What do you want? Huh? What is it that you need? Huh? Hallelujah. Huh? Sit around and bounce the grandkids, great-grandkids on your knee. That'd be fine so long as you're mentoring them, raising them up to be great champions in the kingdom to take the torch. Huh? But if that ain't happening, man, it's just time. Look, come on, man. Burn out rather than rust out. Come on. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm praying tonight that this that I'm preaching tonight will not be bestowed upon you in vain. I'm praying tonight that the grace of God that is available in this place, that is going forth in this place, the shoutings of God that have been in this place tonight, the prophecies of God, the exhortations of God, the instructions and the teachings of the Spirit of the living God in this place tonight will be not bestowed upon you in vain. That you will not get up and live the same life and pray the same prayers and sing the same songs and dance the same dance. Hallelujah. It gets louder, it gets bolder. We had some people with us the other day off the mission field out there at the ranch. And I said, well, you know, I said, we have prayer at 1 o'clock, and it's about 1 o'clock. And I said, I don't know how we're used to this, but it's going to get real loud in here. I said, I hope you brought your earplugs. And they just thought I was kidding his little chickle, juck, a little chickle, a little chuckle, a little bit of a chuckle. And then 1 o'clock came around and whoa, the sound came. But I'm telling you, it's ear piercing. It was a little bit louder than I expected. Hallelujah. Wow. A rushing mighty wind filled the place. Praise God. Hallelujah. Because some people gathered there together who knew how to pray in the spirit and pray in the understanding also. Hallelujah. People are not all self-conscious about some new folks around, so we got to be, you know, looking at God with one eye and looking at them with the other. Trying to accommodate men. Just so full of so self-consciousness. Can't be who you are in God. Got to always be a modifying it. Huh? So you fit in and you're acceptable. More concerned about what people are thinking than instead of what God's thinking. I grew out of that a long time ago and hope to get you out of that by the end of tonight. Yes. Hallelujah. Praise God. You can't be faithful minister of the Lord Jesus Christ when you always self-conscious and concerned about what other people think. You just time you be who you are in God, the Holy Ghost, wherever you are. I mean, if you're sitting in the coffee shop and a burst of spirit of heaven comes forth from your lips, I mean, let her fly. Let it rip. Praise God. Hallelujah. You don't know what God's going to do through it. You have somebody come up and say, what language was that you were speaking? Who were you talking to? Have you ever had anybody say, who you yelling at? Have you ever had anybody walk up to you and say, who you yelling at? I say, I'm yelling at God. I'm hollering out to the Lord. Hallelujah. You want to join me? I'm calling to him. He'll answer. I'm getting ready to stand before him because in the next few seconds or so, I'll be face to face with God giving an account for my soul. And I've recognized how short that my time is. I'm not squandering my life. I've not made it months and years. I've numbered my days and brought it down to seconds. It's a hand span. It's short. It gets by you real quick. And the longer you live, the shorter you realize it is. The quicker things slip by you. Hurabasateya. It'll only be a few short years that she's going to be pulling all the credit cards out of your wallet and exploring all the depths of your purse. And then it's done. She's going to move on to bigger things. And we want her to move on into things of the Spirit. We want you to move on to things of the Spirit. I wanted to read this verse of Scripture. I don't think, did I ever read Luke 5? Okay.
No.
And it came to pass on a certain day as he was teaching that there were Pharisees and doctors of the law sitting by. Woo. Everybody go, whoa. Whoa. Doctors. The doctors. Everybody modify behavior. See if you can act intelligent. So you can get their approval. No, it happens. Don't you adjust your halo. I'm just trying to lean into you real bit, a little bit. Huh? Oh, he's a doctor. Give me a break, man. And really, what's going on is the Lord Jesus setting up saying, this is the hindrance in the place. The power of God is present to heal them. But the Pharisees and the doctors are there. Are you listening to me?
Yeah.
Power of God is present to heal. Signs and wonders. But the doctors and the Pharisees are there. And everybody's all thinking about trying to get impressed. What they're gonna, how they're going to be viewed by them. How they're going to get a comment. Come on, you hear what I'm telling you.
Yes.
Jesus, help us.
Jesus, help us.
Somebody asked, they said, are you going to put doctor on the new book that Charisma is writing for you? Charisma said, the guys at Charisma says, everybody's doctors now. We figured just leave it off. I said, I get you, man. I understand. I feel you. Everybody's a doctor. Yep. It's lost its value. It's lost its meaning. Everybody's a doctor now. You might have gone to first grade, but you're a doctor. It I'm not as bad as I was, but it used to be when somebody had doctor in front of their name as preacher, it disqualified them in my mind. I said, they must be a cult leader or something. Huh? They must be spirit. They must have spiritism going on. I like the reverend and pastor and whatever, you know, but doctor just disqualified them in my heart and mind. Now everybody's a doctor. They feel like they got to be a doctor. They feel so bad about themselves. Holy Ghost isn't good enough. Signs and wonders and miracles isn't a badge and accreditation enough. They got to have some kind of degree from ministry. Say that somehow they got smarts. They've got ability to think. You know what? I don't know what. I'm not, forget about it. I'm going to meddling again. The power of God is present to heal them. And go ahead and finish reading it. Which were come out of every town of Galilee. Look at that. That's a bunch of docks. Huh? Can I read that again to you? It said, on a certain day, he was teaching, and there were Pharisees and doctors of the law sitting by, which were come out of every town of Galilee. That says an entourage. Are you with me? You talk a bunch of pie faces and a bunch of deadheads. Are you listening? Are you listening to me? Come on. And the power of God is present to heal them, but nobody's getting nothing. It's like a modern day 2016 church in San Diego, California. Pie head deadheads. Pie face deadheads. Huh? And praise God, four ignorant boys came along. Hallelujah. With their friend. Hallelujah. Four good old country boys came with a cot. Hallelujah. Looked into the place and said, it's too crowded in there. Hey, no worry, Joe. Let's climb up on the roof. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Don't worry. I repaired a room just like that the other day. It's easy to get into. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I mean, messing up their clothes down there, messing up their hairdos, and they're all nice suits and everything. The doctor's all plaited out, and now the dust is falling from the ceiling because four good old boys are tearing off the roof. Amen. There was somebody there who had faith to see somebody get healed. That God, Jesus, saw their faith for their friend. I mean, my goodness, dear people, when we start taking our friends to the throne of grace and start tearing the place down and start placing a demand upon the anointing, I'm telling you right now, things are going to change in your family's life. Things are going to change in your neighborhood. Things change in your community. We're too willing to accommodate the Pharisees and the doctors. We're too willing to accommodate the impressions and the concerns of men around us. The good old boys, the country boys, all they could see is Jesus in there, man. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. They weren't a part of the society and didn't want to be part of it either. Hallelujah. The things of this world and the philosophies of men will spoil you and cause you to seek the approval of men and fill you with such a self-consciousness and concern and fear of men and intimidation about men's approval. Our Western society brainwashed you with red marks all over your papers, and many of you participated with that lobotomization. And the grading system of school. Somebody giving you a letter of accommodation and being there to promote you because you're the smartest one in the class, and everybody's seeking the approval of the teachers. That's nothing to do with the kingdom of God. It's not the ways of the kingdom of God. It forms you and fashions you to be something that's contrary to the ways of God. Father would like to teach us humility and brokenness. He would like to teach us compassion These are things that are valuable in the kingdom of God. They're not valuable in a Western society. Your math skills has no meaning whatsoever in the kingdom of God, but your compassion is everything that God is looking for. Your understanding of chemistry has absolutely no value in the kingdom of God. Your understanding of how the world was made is no value in the kingdom of God. You can describe it all. No value in the kingdom of God. But lowliness and meekness is of great price in the sight of the Lord. Hallelujah. Feminist movement has made women all uppity. They didn't even understand anything about what it meant to be a part, a helpmate and co-labor and canon part to their husband, understand what it was in Sarah, where Sarah was so submitted to her husband, so ruled over by Abraham that she called him Lord. And it wasn't ruled over by Abraham in a wrong way. It was ruled over by Abraham in the right and the godly way. God says for you, the women to be just like Sarah. And rather they be just like the devil and fashion himself out of rebellion and feminism and haughtiness. And they got to have the plan. It's got to center around them. Meek and quiet spirit is a great price in the eyes of the Lord. I hope you understand that, women. It's a great price in the eyes of the Lord for men too. Praise God. When we begin to seek after the things of God, and we know that, we know with absolute certainty, and we've been convinced of the Holy Ghost, that these things are for us, and they're there, they're a reward that is there ready for us to step into as we respond in obedience to God, then there is no way that there's going to be anything of this giving up and this wearying in well-doing. And we're going to begin to go after the treasure that Father has for us and not have some kind of concept that, hope deferred makes the heart sick, and we were hoping that these signs and wonders were going to break out and they didn't, and so now we're all so discouraged, we're just going to try to go on and just make the best of whatever song service we have, whatever little bit from heaven God can afford us and spare us in this sojourn. And the rest of our life, because somehow we missed it. It didn't happen by 21. It's never going to happen. These crazy ideas are something that happens with people where they don't just continue to press in and take a hold of that opportunity with a greater ferociousness. What it always will result in is a greater brokenness. Because in that broken, when it doesn't happen the way that God described it, then you don't blame it on God. You recognize, wait a minute, something's going on in my life that's hindering Father. Something's going on in my spirit that is inappropriate. There's an area of my life where I'm not being willing to obey God and walk with God. And it begins to produce a brokenness in our life that God demands. It begins to produce a brokenness in our life that God demands. And I pray that brokenness will begin to take place in your life tonight. Read a few verses of scripture here to you. Just try to move this over into the last part of what I believe Father wants to do in this place. Man, if God's people, if fathers would begin to seek God for their households, and like Job did, everything would be unveiled to fathers, and half the things that go down in a house wouldn't take place. Fathers abdicating their spiritual responsibility. Huh? Come on, people. Get some spiritual strength. You can have big old arms, big old muscles, not know what to do with it. You know what I'm saying to you? It's true. Huh? Because it's not in the bigness of your muscles. It's in your heart. It's your heart. Even in the natural, it's where your passion is in your heart. Don't care how big the person is. You understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
You know how big the mountain is. People go climb Mount Everest, impossible to do. People go run marathons, supposed to die to do it. It's in the heart. It's in the heart. I mean, people think it's in their size. How much more does that then equate over to the things of the Spirit? Where's the heart? Where's your unwillingness to allow anything in your life that doesn't fit the pattern of what God described and commanded for you to be and for you to have? That is either going to create within your life discouragement or brokenness. Discouragement, you allowed Satan to get in the midst of it and turn you his way. Brokenness, you went on with God the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. shaped by His hand. The Lord said in Isaiah 57, verse 15, He says, "For thus says the High and Lofty One." Hallelujah. This isn't Papa talking about Himself. Hallelujah. This isn't Father bragging on Himself. Praise God, because He is. Hallelujah. Thus says the High and Lofty One. He's the only one who's high and lofty. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But the High and Lofty One is broken. The High and Lofty One is lowly and meek. See, Jesus learned obedience by the things He suffered, by the things that He encountered. He as the captain of our salvation, He was made perfect through sufferings. Come on now. Come on now. Father, Jesus tells us to come learn of Him. Come learn how to move in lowliness and meekness. So many people, they don't even want to learn how to do that. They want to have some outward demeanor. No, real humility, real lowliness and meekness has to do with the way that you respond to God's Word, the way you're willing to obey Him, the way you're willing to fashion yourself after Him and not after this world. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thus says the High and the Lofty One that inhabits eternity. My. And now He's been willing to invite us on into the program, that we get to dwell in His place of high and lofty and inhabit eternity with Him. That's got to be bigger to you than anything tomorrow. Otherwise, you have undervalued it and you have profaned it, not even knowing. You have exalted other things in your desire, in your heart, in your passions above God. Maybe not even consciously, but just because you're too distant from Him to be aware of what your actions are saying. Draw near to Him, He'll draw nigh to you. Draw near to Him, He'll draw near to you. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Seek your estepa. Seek Him while He may be found. You seek Him, and you recognize that He is the rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. You come after Him, recognizing that He is and that He is here. And you understand that that is the dimension of faith that He's given you and He demands to be expressed through you. I'm going to tell you right now, you will go after God and you will have those things which He has pronounced for you to have. And ultimately what you will encounter is a state of brokenness and submission and contrition before Him, of lowliness and meekness and willingness to do whatever He demands.
Yes.
True? Say it again until you get it. I don't know, I probably said it at least 15 times. I'm going to say it 15 more. It says, I dwell in the high and lofty place. He's just telling us, there is nobody above me. There is no one beyond me. I alone am at the highest place, the highest realm, the most exalted state. I alone possess the power of the ages. I alone inhabit eternity. It is my realm in which I dwell. And I'm here with everybody who is what? I am here with everyone who is contrite and of humble spirit. This is the place where the anointing flows. This is the place where the miracle life and ministry of Jesus flows. This is the place with towel and basin in hand and you're washing people's feet and you're being servant in the kingdom of God. This is where it happens. When you're a servant in the kingdom of God, I guarantee you, you're servant in the house of God. I guarantee you, when you're servant, it's no problem to be submitted. It's just a state of the servant. It is no problem to be hooked up. It's no problem for you to be able to function and flow in all the things that the Holy Ghost would express through you. Hallelujah. Because there's going to be compassion and love. You're always going to be looking up, never looking down at people. You're going to esteem everybody better than yourself. It's a place of a servant. Jesus esteemed our life better than His. That's why He went and offered Himself for us in our place. And now instead. Here's what He does. He revives the spirit of the humble and He revives the heart of the contrite ones. Tonight, God the Holy Ghost wants to work in your life so that you can see humility and brokenness as something far superior than your own personal greatness and pride. Your own personal greatness and self-exaltation, and put it that way. We're running up against it right here. Somebody said, I just go with the sermons that really preach and really work. It's got everybody happy and flowing in the Holy Ghost and applauding and moving, getting around and praising God and getting all excited. No, you need to be addressing the issue.
Yes.
Hallelujah. And it's not something you get yourself all whipped up into from feeling bad about yourself. It's something that God, the Holy Ghost, produces in you by the Holy Ghost. The same one that produces joy produces lowliness, and it comes the same way. Hallelujah. The same one that produces miracles produces meekness and lowliness. Hallelujah. It's drawing near to the Lord. It's coming to understand who He is and how what He's like. Hallelujah. Jesus said, I showed you the Father. I've come to reveal the Father to you. This is who He is. This is what He's like. That's why the greatest in the kingdom of God, servants of all. And this is the state of the heart. This is the place where you flow and operate and function in the Holy Ghost. It's not something that you can pretend to be. It's something that you enter into because you're in a place where you're allowing the Holy Ghost to develop you. It's a place where you're participating with God so that everything about His character and the working of His mighty power is allowed to have freedom to be expressed through you. That's called prayer. That's called prayer. Hallelujah. That's called praying in the Holy Ghost. That's called being filled with the Spirit, speaking to yourself in song, in spiritual songs. Hallelujah. That's what that's called. That's the realm of cooperation and participation with the teacher who lives on the inside of you and allowing His glory to be expressed to you. Then instead of you walking around, your doubt, frustration, and fear. Come on, people, listen to me. I watch it all the time. People accommodate fear, frustration, and all the rest of the stuff they got going on, and they say it's God's will. No, it's your stupidity. It's your unwillingness to be obedient. When I say stupidity, I mean it from that level. That means that you're completely unconscious of where you're at and what you're doing. Are you with me?
Yes.
Hello. And Father wants to brighten you up.
Yes.
Amen. He wants to make you aware of your environment.
Yes. Yes.
And your behavior and actions.
Yes.
Praise God. Isn't that wonderful?
Yes.
I'd hate to be a cow. I look at those cows and I think, God, thank you. I'm not a cow. The fish just sitting there. Father, I thank you that I'm not a fish. The chickens. We get this so blessed to be men. Hallelujah. Male and female men. Hallelujah. Created in the image and likeness of God. Hallelujah. And then the privilege of being born again. And given in a monkitai. His brokritai, His spirit. We have more than Daniel had, and kings, the great kings of the earth, recognized the power of God in his life. We have more than Joseph had, and the great rulers of the earth recognized the authority of the Almighty God in his life. Come on, people. Come on now. Come on. Come on, somebody has got to say, look, enough is enough. The king don't have no clothes on. Huh? Somebody said, this ain't what it's supposed to be. Come on, but the pretend has got to stop. The religion has got to come to an end. Somebody's going to have to contend. Somebody's going to have to press in. That sounds like work. I know for all you lazy folks, it is work. It is a fight. It is to contend for the faith that was once delivered unto the saints. It is a press. The place where you press in. You press past all that would hinder, all that would stop you, all that would try to resist you. You begin to start living out a life of freedom in the Holy Ghost, where being part of the things of the kingdom of God and taking care of the needs of the kingdom of God and visiting the people that are sick and visiting the people that are in prison and visiting the lost and just being a part of anything that's going on in terms of advancing the gospel and preaching the gospel is a joy and delight, not some kind of an obligation in the way. Oh, no, messing up another Saturday. No, you need to forget about messing up another Saturday. Quit your job. Give God Monday through Saturday.
Amen.
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 And then, you know, come on, Sunday too. Well, we're only giving Sunday to God. That's nonsense. That's just religion. Father wants to change every part of our disposition.
Amen.
And when we begin to get hungry and thirsty about the reality of heaven, when we begin to understand that God has demanded that we bring forth this fruit of relationship, that whatever we ask, He'll do it. When we understand that God has purpose and He demands the manifestation of the Spirit be in our life, and we're not willing to go on without it. He demands His gospel be preached with signs and wonders and demonstration of the Holy Ghost, and we're unwilling to continue to have a life of powerlessness. I'm telling you right now, change will begin to take place in your life. Brokenness will begin to take place in your life. Pressing in will be a natural result. Contending will be just the way you live. Instead of accommodating. instead of being assimilated. Hallelujah. Miracles are going to happen when you plaster Jesus all over it.
Yes.
Psalms 34. The Lord is near unto them that are of a broken heart. Are you there? Psalms 34, verse 18, everybody?
Yes.
You there?
Yes.
The Lord is near unto them that are of a broken heart. Look, people want to have revival, and they don't want to be contrite and broken. He's there to give revival to the broken. Huh? He's there to give revival to the contrite. He's there to give the outpouring of the inheritance to show people how to move with him that are in this place, in the Holy Ghost. The Father demands a state of the heart of submission and surrender, which Father demands. Sit down, baby. Sit right there, baby. Right there. Listen to Papa. Listen to Papa. Are you there? Psalms 34, 18?
Yes.
Are you there? We love you so much, darling. You're amazing. You're amazing. You look just like Mimi did when she was rich. You're amazing. Hallelujah. Ki sotaranapahaya. She's going to be a radical Holy Ghost woman. Hallelujah. Sukatarabo sivritesht. Praise the name of Jesus. Anointing's all over right now. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Are you there? Psalms 34, 18.
Yes.
It says the Lord is nigh unto them that are broken heart.
Yes.
And? Huh? Huh? Anybody? What? If you're going to say it, get some gumption with it. Come on, people. Open up your mouth and let something come from your diaphragm, or don't say anything at all. Praise the Lord. I want you guys to get out of being under the oppressive spirit of Southern California.
Teacher, is it okay if I say something to them?
No, shut up. Get out of that oppressive thing. Get yourself some boldness, man. Get yourself some Holy Ghost boldness. You're going to say something, say it properly. You know what I'm saying? Or just be quiet so we can understand. A murmur. Oh, oh, oh. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And saves what? I've often wondered, does anyone even know what that means? Contrite spirit. Huh? Does anybody even in a modern age understand, in postmodernism and secular humanism, even understand what a contrite spirit is? Hallelujah. And praise God, there's a couple of you going, mm-hmm. And a yep?
Yes.
Yes. Hallelujah. I do over here. Amen. Three people. Everybody else is afraid to pass, fail the pop quiz. Get yourself some boldness.
Amen.
Break free of those chains that you've been bound with since elementary school. Huh?
Amen.
Huh? Amen. Kindergarten, preschool. Preschool, they started the satanic lobotomy to conform you to the image of the satanic realm, to conform you to the image of men. I'm not kidding you. And it's even getting worse. Because now they're going to teach kindergartners how to call the marriage of a man and a man equal to a man and a woman. That's just absolutely gross. It's hideous. Huh? That is satanic. I'm telling you. Huh. Some people have it trying to get Elizabeth to sign a petition. Some homosexual group trying to sign a petition. I just told them, I said, tell them they're in such an insignificant minority, they don't even rate recognition. And she went and told them that. And they're like, oh man, that hurts. Well, it is. They're such an insignificant minority who got a greater passion in the demonic that they have greater authority than the people in the church who supposedly got the Spirit of God. And that should work brokenness and contrition in your life, because you and I are so powerless. This should begin to cause us to cry out to God and say, Father, somehow we don't get anything. We are so clueless that we barely even register on the radar of being your people. We come under the heading of supernatural mercy and grace. You can hear me. Can anybody hear me?
Yes.
Botaranea, baby, I got to preach. You sit there. We'll let you preach tomorrow night. Monday's yours. Hallelujah. There's millions of millennials right now to reach. But there's got to be a transformation. There's got to be a change. There's got to be people that begin to cry out to God who first and foremost cry out for their households. If everybody's household that's even in the city was represented, was here in this church tonight, the place would be jam-packed. These people. Somehow we've got to move past those things that are accommodating us and those things that suit us and feel good to us and start feeling some pain. Start feeling some pain. It's called suffering. Start feeling some pain. Start feeling some brokenness. Start feeling some agony. Start feeling, Some compassion. Start feeling some burden, Start dealing with the lack of the revelation of Jesus Christ in our life to a lost and dying world. Psalms 51:17. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, and a broken and contrite heart God will not despise. These are the sacrifices of God. This is what Father's looking at. This is what a sacrifice of God are, the offerings that ultimately the sacrifices, understand, the sacrifices is that which by that means by which you may come and interact with God. In the name of Jesus, be healed. In the name of Jesus, be healed. No flus and sneezes and respiratory diseases on the front row. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Healed. 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 The sacrifices of God are the means by which you were allowed to come and interact with God. Hear me. The sacrifices of God, listen to me. All of those who cannot hear, I command you to hear now in the name of Jesus. Those of you who are spiritually deaf, I circumcise your ears right now. You've got to hear me. You foul spirit of being deaf and mute, I'll bust you right now, smash you.
Amen.
And no longer torment the people of God.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
That the people of God may hear and speak.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Sacrifices of God is the means by which you were allowed to come and interact with Father. He says the sacrifices of God are, in other words, the means by which you were allowed to come and interact with Him is a broken spirit and a contrite heart. These are the things that God will not refuse.
Amen.
Literally, God will not despise. I think it's a great word. Yeah. People coming to God and presenting themselves all uppity about who they think they are, and God just despises it.
Yeah.
It's just you, man. It's just you. Cain, it's just you. I'm not going to do nothing with your offering. I reject it. I reject you. Somebody said, well, I just try to be good and just try to do what's right. I just tell people right up. That's not acceptable to God. You rejected by God. There's nothing about you that is acceptable to God. You got to be transformed. You got to be born again. And that means you're going to be crucified with Christ Jesus, buried with Him by baptism into His death, and raised up a new creation that has no resemblance of the former man and the former conversation. It's now in Christ Jesus and living in God. And there's a lot to say on that. And it just doesn't seem like there's a whole lot of people living that. Isaiah 66:2. Bavato kore mesika. Abba provokushi malesika. Habavakutasi atila masia. That the people in this place, Father God, will not be more moved by sleep than they are by you. Be not more moved by a need to eat food than they are by the hungers of the Spirit. Father, that the earthly human passions aren't more impactive upon their being than those things that you're doing by the Holy Ghost in our life. Somebody's going to have to press in. Somebody's going to have to contend for the faith. Somebody's going to have to get past their nap time. Somebody's going to have to get past all their leisure and their comforts and their love of ease and their lukewarmness and begin to contend. I guarantee you every time it's time for you to go to prayer, you'll be tired. You'll be a little sleepy. It'll be a little blah, 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 and fall asleep. And it'll be about that valuable. But if you'll rise up and begin to lift up your voice and begin to get radical with God, begin to get serious with Him and say, Lord, I don't want anything dominating my life but you. I recognize what's going on right now, and I thank you that you strengthen me and you empower me, the ability to break through. Father, I want to count. I want my life to be what you described it to be. I want to be defined by you and not defined by man anymore. Something's going to begin to happen in a more intense way in your life. The Spirit of the Lord is going to have freedom to move in you.
Amen.
I don't really believe that very few people on the planet even believe that God has moved into their life. I mean, when it really comes down to behavior, I don't really believe that there is much witness that there are that many people who believe that God Almighty has moved into their very being and lives and habitates within their body. I don't believe it. They're too conformed to the world. They're too wrapped up in the thinking of men and in compromise. They're too conflicted to believe God Almighty inhabits their very being, walks in their feet, talks through their mouth, lives in their heart, breathes through their breath. Think about it. Breathe through my breath. Becoming the very living atmosphere in which I inhale and exhale. It's time we quit playing games with God. Start contending for some reality here. It's time that you stop allowing everything to be convenient for you. And suit whatever accommodates your leisure and your comfort. God said, fall upon the rock, not fall upon the bed. He didn't say, fall upon the bed and be comforted. He said, fall upon the rock and be crushed. Amen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Or the rock will fall on you and smash you. That's Jesus, a radical preacher, man. Hallelujah. Somebody said, no, the scripture says, you'll fall upon the rock and you'll be broken. Fall upon the rock and you'd be crushed. It's a synonym. Broken, crushed. You like broken a little bit better? Give me a break. Trying to get a cheaper way out? I'm telling you, they synonyms. They both don't mean the same thing. Supoterate. Hallelujah. Fall upon the bed and be comforted is where most people live. Huh? They walk around perplexed the next day on Monday morning. Somebody says, what happened to you? Well, the pastor was a little hard on us at church last night. Jesus. He's talking about being crushed and smashed and broken and living off for God and just totally messed up my whole world. I'm so conflicted now, I don't even know what to do. I went to the meeting saved and left lost. Praise God, we're getting somewhere. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Breakthrough. Breakthrough. Pushilia patana. Breakthrough. Para sefrite. How many of you are dancing every day? Look at how many obedient people. Everybody raise your hand. You dancing every day. You dancing. That's how many obedient people. The rest of you disobedient. Just disobedient. Everybody raise your hand. Raise your hand. Just raise your hand. That's how easy it was for you to dance every day. Huh? I go to prayer and my feet immediately get set to dancing. I don't even have to think about it. I just feel it, man. Baby? Come on now. All you got to do is obey God and quit living your own life and being so smug and self-sufficient. Start pressing in, get broken, start obeying God, be converted and become like a little child where you imitate those who imitate Christ Jesus, where all you do is model after God and start doing what it is He does. Come on, people. Come on, people. Come on, people. Come on now. When the rest of you can start being obedient. You can't be obedient in some small thing. You'll never be obedient in any other thing. You'll barely even make heaven. You'll be making heaven by the skin of your teeth if there is such a thing. Slipping in on the banana peel, and I don't think it's real. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
You don't see God with all your heart. I'm telling you right now, you don't even deserve heaven. You don't even deserve what Christ Jesus gave to you. Come on now.
Yes.
Didn't deserve it in the first place, but at least you can be appreciative of what God has done.
Amen.
Come on.
Yes.
Start obeying God.
Yes.
Can't even dance around a little bit. I'm not even talking about rejoicing. I'm not even talking about prayer. You can't dance. I'm sure you're not praying or rejoicing either one, because if you was praying and rejoicing, you'd be dancing too. All you're doing is murmuring and complaining and calling it prayer. Huh? All you're doing is confessing your doubt and unbelief and saying it was intercession. I tell you, I got the floodlight of heaven, and it's beaming down right on top of you. You might say it ain't true, but I tell you right now, it'd take you a couple of months to catch up with this revelation, but it's going to happen. You're going to go, my goodness, what he was saying was true. It's really true. I thought he was just exaggerating in the meeting. You're trying to make a point. I thought it was one of those hyperbole things. It's time to get real. It's time to get real.
Yeah.
It's time to get real.
Amen.
Yes. Can I read your notes?
Yes.
Harabaka shepe kitahili. Hallelujah. Habasa, that's good notes. Hallelujah. From Dandese Kitala Makanatom Rosaya. Can I read your notes? Just see what you're taking down. See if it's worthwhile. Hallelujah. Only you can read that. Need an interpreter. Hallelujah. Somebody said, you're going to be tested. You're going to be tested. You know what I did when I was in school? I found the smartest girl in the class who made the best grades in the class, and I copied her notes. I said, can I copy? Will you allow me to copy your notes?
You can copy my notes.
And she would give me her notes to copy. Every class I had me a girl. Well, in the right way. Some wanted money, but I didn't pay. Give me your notes. Because I wanted to learn. I wanted to get it right. I want a smart person who's taking the notes. They're getting the points. They're getting the points. That's good. Pretty much everybody got the points. I couldn't read what Leslie had. You know what point I was looking for? Dancing around. I know that just seems completely so new. It's new. It's like solving a multivariable equation. It goes way beyond. How are you supposed to do that on a daily basis? Thank you, Lord Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord. Then I had myself another girl who typed up all of my reports. And she stayed with me. We eventually got married. Hallelujah. And I've been blessed every day since. I am so blessed, baby. God. I have proof that the Lord loves me. Special, has a special love for me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Let me read this verse of scripture to you. How many of you are going to dance every day? I'm still rocked by five people raising their hand. Dance. Dance around. Start rejoicing in the Lord. It'll change things in your life. Chapter 66, verse 1. Thus says the Lord, the heaven is my throne, the earth is my footstool. Where is the house that you will build unto me? Where is the place of my rest? Just to imagine that God, the Holy Ghost, would come pour out His Spirit upon us in such a way that we would be made the temple of God, the Holy Ghost. Where He would come and live and dwell on the inside of us and inhabit our lives. Because what prophet Isaiah is saying here in Isaiah 66 in verses 1 through 2 is absolutely no different than what Jesus described, what Paul described when he said that we were the temple of the Holy Ghost, what Jesus described when he said the Holy Ghost would come and be with us and in us, that Father would come and make His dwelling, He'd come and make His abode on the inside of us. It's no different than what Isaiah the prophet is saying. He says, for those things have been mine, I made them. Those things have been, says the Lord, but to this man will I look. Even that one who's poor, contrite, trembles at my word. It's that place before Him that says, I need you, Lord. I need you. Father, I don't even want to be the only reason that I could be involved in secular things and working a job is because it meant nothing to me. It meant nothing to me. I never took it home, and it meant nothing to me. I mean nothing. I go there, occupy. I do the job, be what God wanted me to be as a witness in the place. It meant nothing to me. I didn't care about their promotions. I didn't care about their raises. I didn't care about nothing that they had to do. Whatever happened, God was going to give it to me. It meant nothing to me. Huh? I watch people, they carry their jobs around with them, their workplace, their raises, their promotion, what the boss thinks about them, what their community thinks about them. Give me a break. How? You're so compromised. You're so compromised. Father wants to, you need to quit your job and be poor. You need to quit your job, collect cans or something. I don't know. Huh? Maybe you just care, be worried about cans all night. Where are you going to find cans? Put yourself in Father's place for a little bit. Where He's looking for laborers, people who will receive that which He's freely given of all that He Himself possesses, the high and the lofty one, the one who inhabits eternity. The one who made all these things, who's looking for some people that He might express His person and His glory through, and all of us are real busy. Lord, we'll get to you later. We're just real busy. Father said to us through His Son, only begotten Son, Jesus, that those things have got to be completely erased from our thinking and our thought life and our concerns. They're supposed to be removed out of our life because that's what everybody else, that's what the nations seek after. That's just the way of the world. So that's what man's been doing since Adam's fall. Don't you be entangled by it. Don't you in any way be compromised by it. Seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. Forget about the job. Forget about the promotion. Forget about it. Go after the kingdom. If your job is getting you in the way of you going after the kingdom. In the Cane Ridge Revival, there were men. Most of those guys were coal miners. In a coal mining lifestyle, you had to be at work by 4:30, 5 o'clock in the morning. And in that period of time, they had to saddle the horse, hitch up the wagon. It'd take them an hour plus to get to work. So if they're going to have breakfast to get themselves organized, it's up 3 o'clock in the morning. But they weren't getting out of church to 12, 1 o'clock in the morning. The meeting was going on, continuing on, night after night, night after night. Not only the Cane Ridge Revival, but other revivals in the hills, Kentucky, in the Blue Ridge Mountains. If you're going to let your job get in the way, you need to quit your job because you've bowed down to the altar of your job. And you can't have spiritual violations like that and think that they went unnoticed by God. Because I'm telling you right now, you failed the test. You didn't pass the test. You failed the test. The goodness of God is that He allows us to repent, come clean, and start again. But He demands, there's things He demands. He demands us to seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. And then all these things will be added unto us.
Amen.
He'll take care of the rest. Put the kingdom first.
Yes. Amen.
So my job demands me to go do this and demands me to go do that, and I can't do these other things that are there in the kingdom of God for me to do. Then you're in the wrong business.
Yeah.
And if you got down on your face and you started seeking God, Father, to show you other ways. He'll show you ways to where you can make huge amounts of money. You can step into huge amounts of money. I know of people who stepped into huge amounts of money washing people's windows. They make probably 4 to 5 times more than the highest paid person in here. And all they do is wash windows. That's how well your education has positioned you. I know people who said, listen, Lord, we want to run with you and do the things that you want us to do throughout the nations. Give us divine insight. Give us wisdom on how to run with the things of the kingdom and make finances. And they ran with the things of the kingdom and made more finances than most people in this county. We've got things upside down. We need to get them right side up. In Jesus' name, everybody stand with me. Hallelujah. This isn't going to work. This will not work. Let me put it this way. The excuses you use before the Lord right now for why you don't enter into the harvest and why you do not do His will and do the things He's commissioned you to do, that which will not work when you stand before His presence on that day will not work right now. And because you utilize those as excuses, the anointing of God's hindered from flowing through you. So God's calling you to repentance tonight. God's calling you to come and surrender your life to Him. There's a few people here that have carried sickness and disease in their body. And the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ is supposed to so take up the cause that we give Father no rest, but we continue with prayer and supplication. Press into that healing till everybody's healed. But if you're not broken, and if you're not contrite before Him, and you're not living out His life, you're consumed with your own self-interest, and it never entered your mind. You can be so consumed with your own self-interest that you can be in a church that's getting ready to go do a crusade in a nation that's been kept from a crusade for 80 years and you won't even remember to pray for it. Cuba. You can so consumed with your own self-interest that here God's given a divine opportunity and you don't even know how to say, how can I step out in faith and begin to be a part of that and believe God for the supernatural finances so one man does not have to stand in the gap for it. But if you're so consumed with your own self-stuff, because your pride of life, because self-exaltation has dominance over you, you could never walk in that kind of receptivity towards God because that's a place of brokenness. That's a place of living out His life, not your own life. I'm just talking to you people. I'm talking to you about repentance. I'm talking to you about change. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We pray out on the training center. We pray at 1 o'clock every day. Prayer is going on for 30 minutes. If you do not have a noon hour prayer time, a noon hour prayer time, pray at 1 o'clock. If you're praying already at 12 o'clock for 30 minutes, that's fine. Go ahead. 11:30, go ahead. But you better get yourself a place. You need to get yourself a lifestyle. Huh? You need to start walking like Jesus walks, moving like He moves, spitting like He spits. Come on now. Quit living your own life. Quit doing it your own way. Become part of the company. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Well, I forgot, Pastor. Listen, dear people, that doesn't work. All that is a testimony is that you don't have much of a desire for God. That's all that is. I forgot. Why? Because you were busy with what you really desire. You were preoccupied with that which is most important to you. Tonight, I'm calling you to repentance, to make the things of the kingdom of God more important to you than all the other stuff. The Spirit of the Lord is calling you to repentance. He's called you to engage and embrace the privilege of having Him come. He's willing to hear me tonight. The high and the lofty one, the one who inhabits eternity. The one who possesses all things, who heaven is His throne and the earth is His footstool, desires to come and dwell in the midst of you and make you your own, your life, your body, His tabernacle and His dwelling place. Ha! Who would like to have that here? See us, Lord. See us, O God. See us, Father. See us, O God. See us pleading, O God. See us hungry, O God. See us thirsty, O God. See our hearts sincere and broken before you tonight, O God. See us not being, O God, somehow complacent, taking for granted that which you've done. See us broken before you, Father.